Coming to the diagnosis of jejunal atresia, we diagnose the case based upon the clinical presentation and radiography. Clinical presentation. Maternal polyhydramnios. This type of maternal polyhydramnios occur during the later age of gestation, around 34 to 36 weeks. The child presents with bilious omitting. The bile can be up to green in color. The presentation, abdominal distension at around 12 to 24 hours after birth. If the distension is more towards the upper abdomen, it is likely to be a jejunal atresia. If the distension is more of a generalized distension, it can be an ileal atresia. And we have to palpate the abdomen. We have to palpate the abdomen and see whether it is tender. And we have to also see whether there is an erythema over the abdominal wall. And also we have to see whether there is a guarding or rigidity of the abdominal wall, or whether the abdomen is tense. If the abdomen is tense and erythema and all are present, we should suspect a volvulus and a malrotation. If the abdominal distension is present at birth itself, when the baby is born, there is abdominal distension, then we have to suspect a giant cystic meconium peritonitis. Giant cystic meconium peritonitis is due to the perforation of the bowel in utero, which results in the extravasation of sterile meconium and a cyst forming around it by the peritoneal fluid. The patient with jejunal atresia has generally an elevation of indirect bilirubin, and failure to pass meconium on the first day of life is another feature of jejunal atresia. When these features are there, we should suspect jejunal atresia. Now coming to the prenatal imaging. In prenatal imaging, we can see dilated bowel loops in ileal atresia or jejunal atresia like this. But the problem with ultrasonography is a poor sensitive, is not at all a sensitive or specific tool for the diagnosis of gastrointestinal atresia. So if what will we do when we see a picture like that in ultrasonography, we can go for an MRI. If dilated bowel loops with vigorous peristalsis is noted in ultrasonography, follow-up with MRI can be indicated. In MRI, this is a case of ileal atresia. We can see wide dilated bowel loops. This is the in utero picture. Suppose a baby with this prenatal, with or without this prenatal imaging is born, what will be the picture of the X-ray? Picture in X-ray. So, postnatal radiographic findings. This is a picture of, we have seen the double bubble appearance. Here we are seeing the triple bubble appearance. In jejunal atresia, there will be classically a triple bubble appearance. And we can also see that there is a paucity of air shadows. There is a paucity of air shadows in the distal part of the bowel, or in the lower zones where there is rectal gas and the small intestinal gas. Now coming to the ileal atresia. This is a picture of ileal atresia. In this we can see classically, you can see a thumb-sized loop here. This is one of the classical picture of ileal atresia. And we can also see a paucity of air shadows on the lower part of the abdomen. But there is a problem. We don't know. How will we know whether these dilated shadows are colons or colonic shadows or it is ileal shadow? A classical triple bubble appearance is fine. For the diagnosis, it is fine. But when the... But when the picture is not so classical, what will we do? How will we decide whether it is a colonic shadow or not? For that, contrast enema helps us. Why? We can see the colon by its ostrations, right? No. In colonic hostile markings are not marked in newborn. So by looking for the featureless ileum and ostrations in colon, we cannot distinguish whether it is a colon or an ileum. So we have to go for a contrast enema to distinguish if there is any doubtful bowel shadows. So how will we distinguish it? We put in a contrast lexis. We put in contrast towards the colon. The picture of the colon we get will be somewhat like that. It will be a picture of an unused colon. So if in an unused colon, when we put the contrast, I'm tracing the colon, the contrast goes first like this. With a small amount of contrast itself, we get this picture. And this is the supposed cecum. Cecum is supposed to be here. Why is it gone here? We have to look for the position of the cecum in case of ileolateresia. In ileolateresia, there can be a malrotation. There can be a component of malrotation per se, or there can be an entity known as pseudomalrotation. You see, in this case, there is this dilated ileal loop. This is a dilated ileal loop which is pushing the colon and which is pushing the cecum towards the midline, showing this pseudomalrotation appearance. In other cases, in a true malrotation, we can see a cecum somewhere here. So then our diagnosis changes. Here, this is the classical appearance of enema, of barium enema in ileolateresia. Now, in incomplete obstruction, suppose there will be rectal gas, but there will be a dilated ileal loops. We have to go for it. Even if we put in a contrast, it may be contrast enema, it may be equivocal. Then we have to go for a small bowel barium meal follow through or a small bowel contrast enteroclysis. So this is the role of contrast studies in ileolateresia. So once we know the classical pictures of ileolateresia, we can go for the differential diagnosis. The differential diagnosis of ileolateresia include malrotation with volvulus, meconium ileus, interstitial duplication, internal hernia, colonic atresia, dynamic ileus secondary to sepsis, and total colonic aganglionosis. So, how does this all this diagnosis come into play in the diagnosing ileolateresia, differential diagnosis come into play? Let us see. I will explain with a case which I have encountered. So a patient in around the postnatal hour of 16, a patient present with an X-ray like this. There is a dilated gas shadows, not very classical of ileolateresia. There are dilated gas shadows, air fluid levels, and a paucity of shadow on the distal part of the paucity of air shadows on the distal part of the bowel. So we had our first clinical suspicion was ileolateresia. Anyway, since the picture was not classical, we have to go for a contrast enema. While the patient was going for a contrast enema, we pushed in bit of air so that the loops will be more visible. Again, we saw there is a paucity of air shadows in the lower part, and more of the air shadows are towards the right side of the abdomen. So again, whether it is a ileal or a jejunal ileolateresia, again the suspicion was there. Anyway, after that we put in the contrast. So to rule out any Hirschsprung's disease, you can see there is no in Hirschsprung's disease. There is no dilatation of the colon too much. But in Hirschsprung's disease, we are expecting a picture like this: the narrow rectal area and a dilated sigmoid colon. In the classical Hirschsprung's disease, where the transition is in the rectosigmoid zone. Anyway, we are seeing no classical rectosigmoid transition zone, so we have ruled out the rectosigmoid Hirschsprung's disease. After that, what we did was we took an AP view with putting in contrast. So here I am going to trace the colon. Normally, classically, we are expecting a picture like this, where the colon is thin and unused colon, but in this case we got a picture of colon like this. So what the colon, I'm going to trace the colon. The colon is somewhere going like this and ending like this, and there is a loop here. But why is this colon big like this, and is it malrotation? The cecum is in a different position. So cecum is in a different position. Is it a malrotation, or is there an incipitated meconium out there, or is it a meconium ileus which is not allowing to pass the contrast further? Then can this dilatation be due to sepsis? Can this dilatation be due to hypothyroidism? All this thought process came to our mind. I put in a bit more contrast to see whether it was due to the contrast not reaching the around 46, not reaching the ileum. Again, the picture was same. The contrast not was not passing beyond this point. Finally, when we opened this abdomen, we found that it was a malrotation with volvulus and not an ileolateration. And this cecum, this cecum was due to the malrotation, and this dilated bowel loops was due to the volvulus. And this is the picture. This is how all this differential diagnosis come into play in ileolateration. Now coming to the other parts of imaging, this is a picture of a meconium peritonitis. If suppose there is a meconium peritonitis, we can see calcifications like that. We can see calcification here. This white dot of calcifications like that near the liver here. The calcification of the peritoneum is classical of meconium peritonitis, which is due to the intrauterine extravasation of meconium into the abdomen. Intrauterine extravasation of meconium in the abdomen can also show some other picture. If it is more contained, rather than generalized peritonitis like that, if it is more contained, it will form a giant peritoneal cyst like this. We can see a fluid shadow here, which is pushing the bowel towards this side. So this is a giant meconium cystic peritonitis. It is not like the absolute peritonitis, meconium peritonitis. It is more contained. And it can be much more contained where we can see if there is only a bit of an extravasation, we can see a small cyst like this. This appearance is called soap bubble appearance. Where we can see a small, like this appearance is called soap bubble appearance. Now, then we have again another diagnosis, meconium ileus. The meconium is blocking, the meconium is thick and it is blocking the bowel. But in meconium ileus, we can see all the bowel loops are dilated. Almost all the bowel loops are dilated. But there will be no air fluid levels because the meconium will be slimy like that. And it will stay mixed with air rather than settling like the water. So if it is slimy and sticky and standing like that, there cannot be any clear air fluid levels. In water, if it is water and proper intestinal obstruction, it settles and there can be an air fluid level. So that is how with the air fluid levels, we differentiate between meconium peritonitis, meconium ileus and ileal atresia.